Elton Vaughn edits the news.
Good evening, everybody. There's a proposal for a new deal between Japan and the United States, according to what appear well-authenticated reports coming from both Washington and Tokyo. It seems that United States Ambassador Gru's plain talk has cleared the air. The United States Ambassador probably chose this way to help the anti-militarist faction in Japan. It seems as though the Japanese people and some members of the Japanese government are getting tired of the war in China. Now, if they could end it by the simple expedient of first kicking out the military extremists who are still members of the Japanese government, they certainly would do a good service for the cause of peace. And it is possible that with the help which United States Ambassador Gru has diplomatically supplied in telling the Japanese people frankly what Americans think of the conduct of Japanese soldiers with respect to American interests in China, with that help, it is possible that there will be a change in the point of view of the Japanese government. The British government announces tonight that it's going to answer German propaganda minister Goebbels' accusation that British destroyers sank the steamship Athenia. Naturally, the British government has accumulated a good deal of evidence from members of the crew of the Athenia, from passengers of the Athenia as to exactly what happened. And it has these sworn statements available and is probably wise in giving them out to the world. There's been a good deal of loose talk in this country with reference to the Athenia. And it will be just as well to see what documents the British government has with reference to that particular sinking. The United States is losing its patience with the unlawful actions of subversive organizations and agitators. Earl Browder was indicted today, charged with traveling on a false American passport. The indictment grows out of the communist leader's testimony before the Dies Committee. It has been charged that both communists and Nazis make a regular practice of using forged American passports. Evidence to this effect played a prominent part in the recent Nazi spy case in New York, and similar evidence was given before the Dies Committee. Well, now that both Earl Browder and Fritz Kuhn are out on bail, we're once more neutral as between Nazi agitators and communist agitators. It will be interesting to see how long it will be before Nazis and communists unite their propaganda efforts in the United States. The British Air Ministry announced today that two Nazi submarines have been attacked and probably destroyed. The announcement reads that after both attacks, the plane circled above the places where the submarine disappeared and nothing more was seen of the U-boats. And it's interesting to read the testimony of the pilot of the British plane which carried out the North Sea attack. He says this: "I sighted a submarine and attacked with a salvo of anti-submarine bombs, aimed to strike just ahead of the U-boat's periscope. The submarine dived at a steep angle, and my gunner noticed a second explosion underwater. After the explosion of these bombs, we dropped another salvo. Patches of oil were observed. Nothing more was seen of the U-boat." End quote. Now, in the attack on the Atlantic, the pilot of that plane reports as follows: "My first thought was that I scored a direct hit. Dark objects appeared in the water, and a stream of air bubbles rose to the surface." End quote. Now, it's worthwhile to point out that there is a good deal of wishful thinking in connection with all these air attacks. After all, the pilot of a plane cannot be certain of exactly what his hits accomplished. Sometimes he can be fairly sure, but never can he be quite positive, unless, of course, he makes a full hit on a battleship and the battleship sinks. That probably he could be certain of. But outside of that, when a plane drops bombs on a submarine or on a submarine periscope or near where a periscope was seen, it's pretty difficult to be sure that the submarine was destroyed. And we must remember that what William James once called the will to believe is one of the strongest things in the minds of men. Now, I don't say that to discount what these British pilots have reported, but we must remember they are young men. These are probably their first experiences. And when the will to believe that you've done a certain thing is very strong, and there is some circumstantial evidence that you have accomplished what you will to believe, then it is still possible that with the best and most honest intentions in the world in your report, that you may still be mistaken. Submarines today sank one British, one Swedish, and one Norwegian merchantman. The Norwegian merchantman may have been sunk by a mine, but it is evident that submarines are still active. A damaged British merchant ship returned to port tonight and reported that it had scored a direct hit on a German submarine, which was sunk later by British warships, which answered the merchantman's SOS. Now, that's the second instance in which an armed merchant vessel has reported a successful attack upon a submarine. But of course, attack in the sense that it defended itself with its guns when it was attacked. Now, there's a difference between an armed merchant ship and an armed raider. One is equipped for offense, the other for defense. British merchant ships, a good many of them, have had one or two guns placed on them for purposes of defense. The United States Senate was ready to arm American merchantmen in the last World War, and 11 willful men prevented it by filibuster. Before the United States entered the war, the Wilson administration sought to protect American ships against attack by giving them the means of defense. This was after the Germans had declared unrestricted submarine war. The House of Representatives voted 403-13 in favor of putting defense guns on our merchant ships. And remember, this was before we went to war. Senator La Follette, father of Bob La Follette, led a filibuster in which 11 senators joined. At that time, congressional sessions expired on March 4th, and there was no cloture rule to limit debate. And it's interesting to recall that Senator Norris, the only one of that little group of willful men, as President Wilson called them, still in the Senate, is responsible for the constitutional amendment which has eliminated the March 4th date. When President Wilson was unable to get an armed ship bill from Congress, he got an opinion from his attorney general that he could arm American ships without the consent of Congress. With that, and public opinion in Congress and the country to back him, he put guns and gunners on American ships. It is an interesting precedent, which may be referred to many times before this war is over. And if the president is sound, President Roosevelt could order every American ship sailing to any foreign port to be armed tomorrow. An attempt by Senate Majority Leader Barkley to limit the neutrality bait was blocked late today by isolationists. Remember that we've been expecting that Congress would shortly adjourn. There's been much talk that the debate should be closed, and the leaders of Congress told the president today that they believed that Congress could adjourn by November 4th. But the isolationists are still fighting. They're beaten now, and they know it. But they're still hoping that something might happen to change public sentiment. Senator Clark of Missouri said today in his talk against lifting the embargo that plans already are drawn and ready to be pushed through Congress to organize the country for war. And he described the industrial mobilization plan, and he warned us against war hysteria. Of course, some congressmen believe that the plan to mobilize the country for war should be debated and adopted now before war hysteria develops. It's going to be a closer vote on the embargo in the House than in the Senate. Already the members of the House, anticipating repeal by the Senate, are going on record. Today, Representative Leland M. Ford, Republican of California, said that he favors repeal as the safest course for America to follow. Ford voted for the embargo at the last session. Now he says that he believes it is impossible to enforce it properly and that it might lead to smuggling and gun running. Of course, the chief danger of violating the embargo is not from gun running, but is through legal sales of munitions and arms to neutrals. That is, Russia and Italy, even if the embargo is lifted or is not lifted, can buy all they like in the way of munitions because they're not formally at war. And remember that the embargo applies only to declared belligerents. Senator Porter is still, in the opinion of many people, the ablest orator in the United States Senate. His speeches against the embargo on the floor of the Senate and over the radio seem to have made a greater impression than any others, unless we accept Colonel Lindbergh's first speech and, of course, President Roosevelt's appeal made directly to Congress. Senator Borah's speech was carried in full by at least one Chicago newspaper. It happens to be the paper that agrees with Senator Borah on this issue. But even so, it isn't every day that any Chicago newspaper prints a senator's speech in full. The Midwest seems to like the senator's blasts at the British government. The Middle West doesn't seem to like Mr. Chamberlain any better than Mr. Borah. Mr. Borah's declaration that the present British government took a long time to get excited about the wickedness of Mr. Hitler finds considerable editorial approval in this part of the country. After reading the Borah speech, I was struck with the almost exact parallel between Borah's and Lloyd George's attack on British policy. Read the last chapter of this World War Prime Minister's memoirs, in which he outlines the mistakes that the British government has made, and you'll find that there isn't much difference of opinion between Lloyd George and United States Senator Borah with respect to sharp criticism of that government for the policy which it has followed in dealing with Nazi Germany. And that fact is significant. Good night.